Hey you, I'm good at games, and this week's video is a special one, because we're going to be taking a look at the rarest type of game on the market, a side-scrolling indie platformer with a retro-inspired art style. This particular game is called The Messenger, and it's made by Sabotage Studios. After watching the cliche intro about a demon army trying to rule the world, and the chosen hero who must save the day, you might think the story is uninspired. But as you play through the game, it becomes clear that the Messenger's story isn't trying to recreate the NES era so much as parody it. The dialogue is surprisingly great, and never failed to tickle my funny bone, along with many other body parts. Most dialogue unfolds between our hero and a snarky interdimensional shopkeeper, who can be visited at certain points throughout the game. Their conversations range from information about the area you're in, to random stories that have no bearing on the rest of the game. But they're always worth a read. The overarching story never gets too deep, but there are some enjoyable twists and turns to be had. If you're illiterate or allergic to words, most dialogue can be skipped. But I wouldn't recommend it as it adds a lot of personality to the experience. But this isn't a book, so let's move on to the good stuff. The gameplay in The Messenger is like if you took the old Ninja Gaiden games, cut out all the unfair garbage, added a dollop of modern-day polish, and baked until golden brown. You have your standard run, jump, and attack that you'd expect, but one notable addition to our hero's moveset is cloud stepping, which allows you to jump again by slashing something with your sword while airborne. It's basically a double jump, but more violent. As you progress through the game, more abilities get unlocked, like the climbing claws, wingsuit, and rope dart, which make getting around the world a blast. And since this is a video game in 2018, you also have access to a skill tree to give you extra helpful abilities, unlocked by spending time stones. This game's equivalent to coins. Instead of having lives, your penalty for dying is having a little red pixie man named Quarble follow you around, taking any time stones you collect until he's satisfied. If dying and losing your money wasn't bad enough, he'll also insult your pro gamer skills and aggressively tickle your parents. He's a pretty good addition to the game overall, and I like how he discourages grinding time stones by taking the ones you would have otherwise recollected after dying. Your average Josh will probably encounter Quarble quite a bit on their adventure, as this game gets fairly difficult. Emphasis on fair. You'll die a lot, but it rarely feels cheap, and checkpoints are plentiful enough to keep you going. My only real complaint about the core gameplay is that the climbing claws sometimes got me stuck to walls at inopportune times. It's like the main character dipped his hands in glue, filled with magnets. Or maybe the walls are made out of you, because you're so gosh darn attractive. Aside from that, the levels are all tightly designed, complete with secrets to find, a bombastic chiptune soundtrack, and fantastically fun boss fights. But some of that changes a bit later in the game. At a certain point that I won't spoil, time travel is introduced, and this nice-looking 8-bit styled game turns into a nicer-looking 16-bit styled game. And a few levels after that, it goes from being an expertly crafted linear experience to a decently crafted Metroidvania, where you hop between two time periods to solve puzzles. This means that the constant stream of new levels, equipment, and bosses come to a grinding halt, and you must now explore all previous levels to find new paths and 8 mandatory collectibles. On one hand, seeing all the previous stages with the new art style and revamped music is pretty cool, and there are entirely new additional areas and character interactions to sprinkle in some freshness. On the other hand, having to travel back and forth through the same areas multiple times to get to the new stuff sucks balls, especially when the fast travel is near worthless, and you can only access it from a few checkpoints. I appreciate the ambition of trying to completely change the subgenre halfway through the game, but the way it was handled could have been better to reduce the meaningless padding. It's like those people who have a perfectly good watermelon, but then dump salt all over it. Sure, it's still watermelon, and some people might like the added taste of garbage, but for me, it would have been better to leave it out. In the case of this game, despite a little salt, I'd still put it up there with Shovel Knight, as far as watermelons go, and I don't regret playing through it in the slightest. And that's why I'm giving The Messenger a buy it. It was mostly great, and even the lows are still pretty good, but if you absolutely hate the Metroidvania style, or games about ninjas, you might want to wait for a sale. Well, that's all I got for now. But if you want to see more reviews and other videos I don't know how to label, subscribing would be appreciated. You can also leave a comment to let me know what you think about The Messenger, or anything really. I'll read it. See you next video.